Imagine your life if you were told you would never walk again. Would you give up? This week's guest defied the diagnosis and went on to not only walk, but run a 52-mile ultramarathon. Today, we talk about how to create your own miracle morning. Hal Elrod, the number one best-selling author of what has been widely regarded as one of the most life-changing books ever written, which has over 700 five-star reviews on Amazon. The Miracle Morning, the not-so-obvious secret guaranteed to transform your life before 8 a.m. Hal's incredible story began when he actually died at the age of 20. He was hit head-on by a drunk driver, broke 11 bones, died for 6 minutes, and spent 6 days in a coma, only to wake up to find out that he may never walk again. After a transformation of mind, body, and spirit, Hal has become a Hall of Fame business achiever, an international keynote speaker, and one of the world's top success coaches. So welcome, Hal. I'm so glad to have you on the show today.
Mamika, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
Well, I am so excited to dig. I've been reading your book on the Kindle, and what I love about it is that you touch on a lot of things that we're going to talk about today. But before we get into the juicy bits of exactly the whys and hows of the tips of becoming more of a mornings person, even though I know I have to profess I'm not one myself, so I'm working on it.
Not
and your
yet.
Book is helping.
On your way.
Exactly. I'm on my way. I want to sort of delve into how this all started. Now, we know where you are right now, which is totally fabulous, and I'm totally inspired by what you do. But take us back, take the audience back to exactly where you were, because that's pretty much a big life-changing moment, right? Being hit by the car and dying at the age of 20.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those things that you think would never happen to you. And even when it did happen to me, it still felt kind of surreal, like it was this out-of-body, in-body experience. It's hard to explain, but I came out of the coma and the doctors were saying I'd probably never walk again. I had really significant permanent brain damage. Couldn't think clearly, had no short-term memory, and really had to make the decision that we all make, which is when we face adversity, how are we going to respond? Mm-hmm. And my parents were really devastated. Seeing their son in the condition in the hospital, I had 11 broken bones, and the thought that I might never walk again was really devastating for them as well. And I told my parents, I said, look, Mom and Dad, you know, they were really crying and upset. I said, you guys, there's only one of two possibilities, and they're both going to be great. I said, number one, if the doctors are right and I never walk again, I've already accepted it. I've already decided that I'll be the happiest person you've ever seen in a wheelchair. I said, because I'm in a wheelchair either way, so I can either be miserable in a wheelchair or happy in a wheelchair. It seems like an easy choice. I said, but the second possibility is I will walk again. And mm-hmm. I said, that's where all my energy is going into. I don't worry about the what might go wrong, or I don't worry about the worst case scenario. I've accepted the worst case scenario, so I'm free from the pull that it would create, the negative emotion that it might create of fear. And I'm completely focused on visualizing, taking my first step, walking again, getting back to my life the way it was before the car accident. And I don't think it was a coincidence that a week later, 3 weeks after the crash and I was found dead, the doctors came in with routine x-rays and they said, we don't know how to explain this, but we're going to let you take your first step tomorrow in therapy. And so 3 weeks after the crash, I took my first step and I was, you know, back on the road to recovery. And I think that the lesson for that for everybody is that it really is not what happens to you. It is how you respond to it. And,
right.
and things can either destroy you and devastate you and discourage you, or they can empower you and you can use them as fuel to, you know, to become great and to impact other people's lives mm-hmm. as well.
And that amazes me, that the fact that at 20, because not many of us get to that stage in our life where, or it takes years or something drastic to happen like that, where you realize, okay, I can make a choice. Because I speak to a lot of people, from moms to business CEOs of across different ages and stages and countries, and we all have this inner conversation, right, that goes on in our minds. So with you lying in that bed, what kind of thought process that got you there that made you decide so quickly, listen, I'm not going to accept this diagnosis. I've decided to think differently. Could you share about that?
Yeah, and I absolutely know what it was. One of my favorite stories from the accident experience, the hospital, is my parents were called in by the doctors one day the doctors were concerned. They mm-hmm. sat my mom and dad down and they said, we're very concerned with Hal. We believe he is in denial. And they said the reason we believe that is every time we see Hal, he's always happy and laughing and joking and smiling. And they said, that's not normal. It's not normal for a 20-year-old young man that's being told he may never walk again. And my dad came in one night, and I didn't know the conversation happened between the doctors, but he basically sat down, and I was laying in my hospital bed, you know, my arms up in a sling, my legs broken, my arms broken, you name it. And this was before I had taken my first step or knew if I ever would. And he said, Hal, hey, you know, the doctors are concerned, and he explained the kind of their concern with me. He said, how are you really feeling, Hal? How are you, know, when there's, I know you're having fun with your friends, you're joking, you're laughing, you're reminiscing, but when you're by yourself at night and there's no one here to distract you, how are you feeling? Are you scared? Are you sad? Are you depressed? Are you angry? It's normal to feel those things. And I really thought about it, and this is the roundabout answer to your question. I realized, Dad, remember I live by the 5-minute rule. I learned this in my sales training. At the time I was in the accident, I was a top salesperson for this company. I said, I learned in my sales training the 5-minute rule, which says it's okay to be negative sometimes, but not for more than 5 minutes. Like when things go wrong, you set your timer on your phone literally for 5 minutes, and you get 5 minutes to bitch, moan, complain.
Have a pity party.
Yeah, have a pity party. Feel sorry for yourself. After 5 minutes is up, you take a deep breath. You say 3 magic words. Can't change it. Right? You can't go. You can't change what's in the past. You can't change it. The only logical, intelligent choice if we want to move forward, move on, and create success in our lives is to accept the things that we can't change and focus all of our energy on what we can change. I told my dad, Dad, it's been more than 5 minutes. It's been like 2 weeks since the accident. My 5 minutes is up. There's no value in me wishing this didn't happen because it did happen. The only value is in dealing with reality, figuring out what I can learn from this, or how can I can use this experience, this adversity, as an asset to improve my life in the future.
Right. So definitely, you kind of went through all the emotions of acceptance right up to, okay, let's get on with it, let's get to the next thing, because you've realized wasting your time wishing, wanting, shoulda, woulda, coulda really doesn't get us anywhere, right? So you very much are, and this is obviously very clear in the book, about decisions and taking action.
Sure. Yeah.
So definitely. So now that you know you've already made a decision, and obviously nobody else wants to believe you, which is also another thing, is how do you continue being positive even when no one else really gets it, right? But how do you pick up the pieces then? So you're going through therapy, right? You start walking, defying everybody, and then did you pretty much, as you said, you mentioned earlier about the visualization, you already saw yourself doing the things that you wanted to do.
Yeah, I focused on seeing prayer, visualization. You know, I mean, I didn't know a lot of these techniques back then. I didn't, in terms of like the things I teach in the Miracle Morning, for example, I didn't meditate. I didn't do a lot of these things. But I did visualize myself walking again, and I prayed about it every day. So I put my energy toward what I wanted. And I really maintained what I would call unwavering faith. Like I maintained unwavering faith that I'm going to walk again. And there's this thing that I teach called the miracle equation, not the miracle morning, miracle equation, which is the way to create extraordinary results in your life or your business is through two components, unwavering faith and extraordinary effort, right? That's the miracle equation. And most people, they don't maintain unwavering faith in their goals or dreams, especially when they hit obstacles. Their faith wavers, right? They doubt themselves. Unwavering faith is a strategy that the most successful people in the world practice. If you think about like Michael Jordan for basketball is like my favorite athlete. And when Michael Jordan was given the ball, I believe, my theory is, most of the world's best athletes have this mindset of unwavering faith, which is where they believe they're going to make every single shot that they take. Now, they know intellectually that's not possible. But when the ball's in their hands in every given moment, I'm going to make this shot. There's no other option. And if they miss that shot, the faith doesn't waver. It's give me the ball again. I'll make the next shot. And if they miss 6 shots in a row, where the average person's faith is very finicky and they go, don't give me the ball. I've missed 6 shots in a row. I don't have any faith in my shot. Michael Jordan says, hey, give me the ball. I'll never miss the 7th one. And if he misses that one, he says, give me the ball again. So if you think about it, in life, I just decided I'm going to walk again. There's no other option, while simultaneously accepting the possibility that I may never walk again. But no energy went into that. Once I accepted it, it was done. I didn't need to put energy into it. I thought, okay, if that happens, I'll be the happiest person you've ever seen in a wheelchair. Okay, decision made. That's the worst case scenario. I've accepted it. It has no control over me. And now I'm focusing all of my energy on the unwavering faith that mm-hmm. I will walk again. And I'm going to go to therapy every day, do whatever the doctors tell me. Sorry, I need a drink of water.
Mm-hmm. It kind of reminds me of like, as a kid, I did horse riding. It's like, if you fall off the horse, you got to get right back on that horse to show that horse who's boss. Because if you let the horse win, it's going to always be hard to train and always be hard to take it in the direction you want to go, right? Kind of the same sort of principles.
Yeah. Life is the horse, right?
It's mm-hmm, like, exactly.
And it's actually your self-concept is the horse. That's really what it is. Your self-concept is the horse. Because if you fall, if you get beat up, if you get whatever, if you give in, you're teaching yourself that it's okay to give in, right? You're literally becoming the type of person that when the going gets tough, you become a victim or you get discouraged or whatever it is.
So it becomes habitual instead of creating negative habits instead of creating positive ones.
Yeah, it's like T. Harv Eker, I think, said it best in his book, Secrets of the Millionaire Mind. He simply said, how you do anything is how you do everything. And that really, to me, is what life is about, is who are you becoming? Not just what are you doing. Most people focus on what they're doing. And I found that when you focus on who you're becoming more so than what you're doing, you can achieve more by becoming more, not just doing more. In fact, when you focus on becoming more, you can often achieve more by doing less, right?
Right.
But it's the becoming. And most people, they don't focus on becoming more. They just focus on doing what they've always been doing or possibly doing more. But they're not they're the same person they've always been because they're not actively learning and growing and becoming a better version of themselves.
So it's kind of like we're just playing the old tapes again and again and again on replay. There's no actual change in direction.
Yeah, exactly. So, I call it rear view mirror syndrome, right?
Yeah.
We've all got this rear view mirror in our subconscious where all of our past experiences are stored. And most people, that's where they create their identity from, like those tapes, as you called them. They go, who am I? Well, they look in the rear view mirror and they go, well, who was I? And they think, well, that's who I am. But the reality is, who you are isn't who you were. It's who you choose to be from this moment on. Most people just don't choose anything different. They just go, yeah, that's who I am. Alarm clock goes off in the morning. They unconsciously check the rearview mirror. They go, what did I do yesterday? I hit the snooze button and completely wasted my morning. I'll just do that again because that's who I am. So I think you've got to see yourself as better than you've ever been before.
Right. So it's always a development, and that's what I love about it. So going back to your story, what I found, and while I'm busy reading it, I'm not completely finished, so I'm still so excited to work through it. But what struck me was, part of your story, okay, you've gone through the car accident. You've now defied everybody's expectations of you. You're running. You're not just walking. And then you create you write the book about your story. Now, tell us a little bit about that moment where you realized that your publisher ran off with the royalties.
Oh, so yeah, my first book. My first book, Taking Life Head On. I've never considered myself a writer. It took me 6 years to write it. Really took me 6 months to write it once I got serious, but 6 years from when I started and I kept revisiting it and then quitting and giving up and having self-doubt and all those things. So I decide to publish the book and I start reading all these other books on how do you promote a book to get the word out. And I went on this speaking tour where I spoke for free all across the country. I'm a keynote speaker. I spoke for free just to collect the audience's email addresses and be able to have a big list of people that I could promote when the book came out. So I did that. The book did really well. It hit number one on Amazon in its category, number six overall out of millions of books. It was the number six book when it first launched, and I was excited. I achieved a goal, and then my publisher abandoned. Like, it was a small publisher, so kind of a ma and pa publisher, and I didn't know any better. And they stole all of my royalties from my book, every single dollar. I never saw a penny of it. And they abandoned their office, their home. They packed up and left, the country or whatever. And I never saw it again. And just had to, and it was another moment where it's funny. I called my dad because my dad knew, I couldn't figure out what happened to the publisher. He wasn't answering my calls or my emails. And then a private investigator was hired by another one of their authors. And they found out that they were gone. And I called my dad to tell him. And he goes, oh my gosh, Hal, he was devastated for me because he knew how hard I worked on this book and then promoting it. He goes, Hal, I'm so sorry. That's terrible. I said, Dad, this is great. What are you talking about? He said, what do you mean this is great? I go, well, look, it's not great. I mean, it sucks, but I can't change it. And if there's one thing I've learned about adversity is that it is our responsibility to turn it into an advantage. And I said, this is just another story where I got to figure out how to overcome this adversity in as quickly and positively and proactively as I can so that I can then pay that lesson forward, and whatever I learn, I'll share it with other people. So right. that's how I handled it.
So even though it's like you've put your life and soul, because I hear this a lot, especially from people in my audience who feel like, you know, they have this dream and they want to achieve their dream. And then when their dream, either they get disappointed, it doesn't happen, or the dream dies, it's almost like they sort of start owning that that shame and that disappointment. But for you, you just brushed it off again. 5 minutes of pity parties and we moved on to the next one.
Yeah, that's it. And that's the thing is when you learn, and this is a, it's like anything, a mindset isn't developed by hearing about it. It's practicing it. And this mindset of acceptance, it really is the key to me. It's the starting place of emotional freedom. When you condition yourself to accept the things that are out of your control, the 5 minute rule is a great way to do that. And eventually you get, by the way, when you change your mindset, you don't need 5 minutes. 5 minutes becomes too long. You know, you go, son of a bitch, and you know, you curse and you moan, and then you look at your watch, you're like, all right, I still got 4.5 minutes. I don't want to sit here and dwell on it for 4.5 minutes. I'd rather spend the next 4.5 minutes doing something about it, right? So 5 minutes at first, I know it sounds like that's not enough time. People are thinking like, I need 5 weeks. Like, you know, can I do at least the 5 day rule minimum, right? Let me be upset for 5 days. It's our first 5 minutes. For me, I thought that's not enough time. But after you do this a few times and you realize that, wow, once you shift and you pivot from resistance to acceptance, you are free from the negative emotions that are created by resistance. Because all of our negative emotions are self-created by our level of resistance to our reality. Once we accept it, there's no negative emotion. There's no pull.
It has no power over you, so you don't have to let it hold you back.
Yeah, and it doesn't mean you're happy about it, by the way. It means you're at peace with it. And that's the thing is, happiness and sadness are emotions, right? And you can be happy 1 minute and get a phone call and that change, now you're upset. But when you live with acceptance, there's this place in the middle between happiness and sadness called peace. And when you're at peace, it's rooted. And it doesn't matter what happens. You just have this sense of, I accept all things that are out of my control, which, by the way, includes everything that's ever happened to you. Because you can't go, unless you're Marty McFly with a DeLorean, right? You can't go back in time and change it. So accepting everything that's out of your control and focusing only on what is in your control, it really is. It's an amazing, you know, it's an amazing thing to.
It's like we need to pray the serenity prayer every day, because that's literally what it is.
That really is it. Yep, that really is it.
So now part of your story as well, which I also found interesting is, you know, when you hear having an accident and, you know, you literally died and came back to life again, it's a huge, huge thing to get through. But what I found interesting is you mentioned that you actually found recovering from your financial failure harder than your car accident. Tell me why.
Yeah. In the Miracle Morning book, I always say that I've had two rock bottoms, right? And we've all had a rock bottom. Everybody watching can relate to this. It is any experience in your life that at that time is the most difficult thing you've ever experienced, right? So we go through those, and they change over time as we grow. You know, it takes a bigger experience to feel like a rock bottom. When you're when you're a teenager, it's like when you get your heart broken for the first time. That's like rock bottom. You know, you're like, how could I live and go on without this person, right? We were supposed to go to the dance together. but for me, you know, the accident obviously was extreme. I never imagined having to go through something like that. And then about 9 years later in 2008, when the U.S. economy crashed, that was my second rock bottom. And to give you just a quick kind of glimpse into my life at that time, I had just hit Hall of Fame with my company. And so I had moved on from that to become an entrepreneur and start my own businesses. So I launched a coaching business. I was a sales coach, success coach, life coach, business coach, all of the above. I launched my speaking career. So I had started, that was my real dream. Like, I wanted to get paid to be a professional speaker. And I was 25 years old. And then I had written my first book that we just talked about, Taking Life Head On, which, yes, the publisher had stolen the profits, but I had rebounded from that. And I had just bought my first house. So I was living in a brand new house. And I had bought my dream car, a little two-door sports car. So it's like life was great. And the economy crashes. And like so many other people, I mean, I wasn't alone in this. My life crashed with it. I lost over half of my clients because they couldn't afford to pay me, lost over half my income, started living on credit cards. I went from being debt-free and very proud to be debt-free, and really that was a value of mine, to 6 months later, I had $53,000 in credit card debt. I lost my house to the bank, I stopped exercising. I was in the worst shape of my life. It really was physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, I was at the lowest point I had ever been at. And it was this 6 month downward spiral where I tried everything to turn it around. And I even, you know, at first I accepted it. I'm like, can't change it. You know, five minute rule, got it. But it's like at that point in my life, I wasn't equipped to handle circumstances that were bad and then got worse and then progressively worse and then worse and then worse and then worse. And just, it just, I'm like, I just felt like I was in quicksand and I'm like, I don't know what to do. Everything I'm trying to fix and move forward, I'm just going backwards. And so to keep a long story short, I went on a run. And on that run, and I wasn't a runner. This was literally the first time I had run in probably 7 years since I graduated high school, you know, when I had to run in my PE class. And I went on a run as a friend advised me, Hal, if you're depressed and you're, you know, you're in this situation, you need to exercise every morning, go for a run and listen to self-help, listen to a business audiobook, and you'll figure out how to turn this thing around. But not if you're sitting at home feeling sorry for yourself. You got to be in a peak physical state every day, emotional, mental state. So I hated running, but I hated my life situation worse. So the next morning I went for a run, and thankfully the very first day, very first run, 2 minutes in, I hear a quote from Jim Rohn that changes my entire life faster than I ever thought possible. And here's the quote. Jim Rohn said, "Your level of success will seldom exceed your level of personal development, because success is something you attract by the person you become."
Ah, so say that again.
Yeah, your level of success will seldom exceed your level of personal development, because success is something you attract by the person you become. And if you think about that, the way that, to me, to help make this really clear, if you quantify on a scale of 1 to 10, what level of success do we want in every single area of our life?
Mm-hmm.
Level 10, right?
Yeah, we'll want to be at the top.
Don't want I'm good with a 6. No, we want to be as happy and healthy and energized and in love and rich as we possibly can. We all want level 10. In that moment, though, I realized, and this is true for most people, my level of personal development, which I define as your knowledge, your confidence, your mindset, your, you know, your peace of mind, your skills, my level of the success I wanted was at a 10. That's what I wanted, but I was at like a 2 or a 3. And that's the disconnect for most people. If you want level 10 success in any area of your life, you have to become a level 10 person in any and every area of your life. Mm-hmm. And my epiphany was, I'm going to go home. I'm going to do like some research online, and I'm going to figure out what are the most proven, effective personal development practices known to man. And I'm going to start doing those every day. And I went home. I spent about an hour. I figured out there were a list of 6 that I came up with, cross-referencing articles online from Entrepreneur and Forbes and Huffington Post and Oprah.com. And the 6 of the 6, I went, which of these should I do? Like, which one or two would have the biggest bang for the buck? And it ended up being, I thought, what if I did all of them? What if rather than choosing one or two of these practices, that any one of these, there are people that swear by as being game changers. What if I did all of them instead of just one?
And these are your lifesavers, right?
These are the lifesavers. Yeah, which the word savers is an acronym for the 6 practices. And I decided to create this little ritual. I woke up the next morning. Now, it wasn't called the Miracle Morning. It wasn't going to be a book. It was none of that. It was like, I'm going to try this to turn my life around. And I had no idea how fast it would happen. It was less than 2 months of doing what is now known as the Miracle Morning and the Lifesavers that I almost tripled my income. So finances were, I mean, I still had, you know, to pay off credit card debt, but it's like, wow, I'm above water finally. So almost tripled my income. Went from being in the worst shape of my life physically to training for a 52-mile ultra marathon. I had never run more than a mile, and I ran 500 miles in 5 months and then ran 52 miles in 1 day. And maybe most importantly is I had been depressed during that time, deeply depressed. That was gone on day one, like literally day one. To be able to cure myself of depression within a day, you know, and I mean, it was still hanging back there. But it's like the beauty of this is every day, if I had a bad day and a client canceled, I wasn't going to bed stressed out to what I was going to wake up to. I was every night it was like I got to hit the reset button and I was going to bed hopeful and excited because I wasn't waking up to my problems. I was waking up to my miracle morning. And, you know, I mean, basically the end result is I shared it with a coaching client and now it's, you know, the things you mentioned in the introduction. I mean, it's, you know, tens of thousands of people around the world do the Miracle Morning every day, and the results they're getting personally and professionally are just are really astounding.
Definitely. Well, I'm excited to really dig in. I mean, and I wanted to read a quote from a book here that I highlighted. One of my favorites is, "Your entire life changes the day that you decide you will no longer accept mediocrity for yourself. When you realize that today is the most important day of your life, when you decide that now matters more than any other time, because it is who you are becoming each day based on the decisions that you are making and the actions that you are taking, that is determining who you are going to be for the rest of your life. And I definitely think that is like a huge sum on top of, you know, what we've been talking about. But let's dive in and give us a little, just give our audience a bit of an idea. So what are the lifesavers?
Yeah, the lifesavers, when I first wrote that list of six, first of all, they were not in a nice acronym the way they are now. That was thanks to my beautiful wife. When I was writing the book, I was stressed out one day and I'm like, sweetie, I can't get my mind around how I'm going to organize these six practices in a way that, you know, makes sense. And it's like a nice package for people to remember them. And she goes, why don't you get the thesaurus and see if you can make an acronym out of those words? And I'm like, you're so brilliant, you know? So the savers are the six practices. And before I run through these, I'll just tell you, when I first had this list, I almost got discouraged. Like I went on this, you know, I went online and I'm doing all this, I'm searching for all these things. I write out this list of these six and I go, I've heard of all of these, right? And like,
that's, nothing's new.
Yeah, our society is conditioned for new. We're looking for new, right? We want the new app. We want the new, it's gotta be new. And, you know, the things that are age old that we've, you know, that have been around, it's like, isn't there something quicker, faster, easier, newer? I almost dismissed these six. And then I realized, wait a minute, based on the research I had just done, some of the world's most successful people swear by each and every one of these, right? You can find one person that swears, for example, meditation, one of the first lifesaver, the S in savers stands for silence. So rather than starting your day with chaos where, you know, you're rushing around trying to get out the door, I call that a mediocre morning, by the way. Mm-hmm. You start your day with peaceful, purposeful silence. And Ray Dalio is one example. You know, he is a billionaire. He runs one of the largest hedge funds in the world. And he is quoted on record saying that meditation is the number one key to his financial success, not his spiritual success. His financial success. And I found an article called Fortune 500 CEOs that meditate. And I was like, I thought meditation was like a spiritual practice.
Yeah,
and
kind I just of like a new agey thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. But the improvements to your, literally the way it, the physiology of your brain, the chemistry of your brain, the way it's impacted by meditation, it has profound benefits, lower stress, et cetera, et cetera. So the first S is silence. The A is for affirmations. And affirmations are written statements that articulate who you are, at least the way that I teach them in a different way than most gurus or whatever teach them over the years. They've been taught as kind of, they're very often the language is flowery or passive. Mm-hmm. I'll give you an example. A popular affirmation, I'll paraphrase it, is money flows to me effortlessly and in abundance. You ever heard one sort of like
I'm
that,
like,
right?
Okay, what exactly does that mean?
Yeah, it's like, it's ridiculous. What does it mean? And here's what it means. It means, well, I don't have to really do anything today to make money because it flows to me effortlessly and in abundance, right? That creates passivity. So my affirmation, the way I teach affirmations is they've got to be, you said it earlier, action-oriented. What do you want? Why is that important to you? What's holding you back from achieving that? And what do you need to commit to do? And in what frequency and duration to guarantee that you achieve what you want? So that's how I teach you to structure your affirmations in the Miracle Morning book, so that you're not just programming yourself with the idea that great things are coming to you and then you sit back and wait for them, right? You know, the law of attraction or whatever, which, But no, you're programming, your affirmations are kind of like when you program a computer. You program a computer to do what you want it to do. Mm-hmm. Affirmations are the way you program you to do what you need to do to achieve everything that you want. Mm-hmm. The V is for visualization. So the V in savers is for visualization. The E is for, and I teach a visualization practice in the book that is different than most, where it's not just visualizing this pie in the sky fantasy and sitting back and going, wow, that's going to be beautiful one day. It's visualizing yourself, not only what you want, but doing the thing that you need to do today, seeing yourself taking the action that will move you toward what you want, and seeing yourself take that action with a smile on your face, with confidence, with energy, etc., so that your vision is so compelling that you want nothing more than to open your eyes and go do the thing that will produce the vision.
Kind of like with an athlete, like my daughter with her run, she's like, oh, but it's going to be pain. Like, well, think about how are you going to feel when you're going over the finish line that you're winning? You see, you feel yourself, you feel your arms moving, you feel your legs moving, and you actually visualize the process. So when you get there, it almost becomes muscle memory.
Yep.
Kind of
like that? Yeah, that's okay. Tiger Woods. A lot of these, well, Tiger's not the best golfer in the world anymore. He's not the best example, I guess. But you know, a lot of the world's best athletes, right? They see themselves doing it in perfect, executing in perfect form over and over and over. And like you said, muscle memory, right? So the E in Sabres is for exercise. And I'm not suggesting that somebody, you know, if you're like, well, but wait, I don't exercise in the morning. I go to the gym in the afternoon or on my lunch break or in the evening. This is the benefits of exercise first thing in the morning are undeniable and profound to the point of where you can't not do them. I mean, you can, but you're missing out. So I'm not saying that you give up your gym time or your running time. I'm saying that you just, in the miracle morning, I show you how to do it in as little as 1 minute a day to get your heart rate up, exercise enough to get the blood and oxygen to your brain, release the endorphins so that you think clearer, you have more willpower, more energy, more discipline throughout the entire day. Mm-hmm. The R is for reading. And I'm not talking about like 50 Shades of Grey or Harry Potter books or whatever.
Self-development books, something that's going to be positive and reinforcing to your mind, body, and spirit.
Exactly. You're exactly right. And then the final S in Savers is for scribing, which is essentially a fancy word for writing, which is usually journaling, right? So, you know, in the book, I talk about the various journaling practices and, you know, how to pick the one that works best for you. But it's one of those things where journaling, the benefits of putting pen to paper and articulating what you're grateful for, articulating what you need to do to make today great and some of these things, the benefits are profound, they're undeniable. So doing all six of these practices first thing in the morning, it really, it accelerates how quickly you become the better version of who you are now that can take yourself to the next level so you can take your success to the next level.
I like to call it the drama dump and decision diary. Dump your drama, write it down. Your diary is your girlfriend. You can bitch and complain. Then when you close the book, you're done. And then your decision, you know, diary. What am I going to do? Get myself off my chishis and start moving.
I love that. I like that.
Well, I've got to say, I'm so excited about finishing the book, first of all. Getting that my whole family involved in the new morning routine, because we are so self-professed not morning people. But that's changing. We'll change it. We have the summer to work on it.
Yeah.
But for everyone who's listening, if you would like to win a copy of the book, The Miracle Morning, written by Hal, you've got to be in this week's goodie giveaway. And remember, you have to be in it to win it. So scroll below the video and enter our raffle copter giveaway. You only have 7 days to enter. So make sure you get off your honey and go and like the pages, tweet about it, share about it, and go stalk Hal on Facebook and tell him you saw him on our show. So I always love to encourage people to take action, because that's how things change, right? By us actually doing, you know, and then we'll see the results. So, and before we wrap up, give us a little quick overview. What is the 6 minute miracle for busy people?
Yeah, absolutely. The 6 minute miracle morning is much like most of the book. It wasn't written, it wasn't created for the book. It was created for me, right? I mean, everything originally was I designed for my own life. And so there were just a lot of days where I felt like I didn't have time. You know, it was kind of a lot of us have an all or nothing mentality, right? And I'd wake up and I'd go, I've got to leave in a half an hour. I can't do my hour long miracle morning, which is normally what I did. A lot of people do a 30 minute miracle morning. I like a 60 minute. And so these days, one day I went, wait a minute, what if I do a 6 minute miracle morning? What if I do 1 minute for each of the six practices, but it's a really intentional, focused minute, purposeful. And so I went through and I did 1 minute of meditation and prayer. I mean, just, you know, real, not very long, but I felt calmer and peaceful, right? I pulled out my affirmations. I read through them. It really only took me a minute to read my affirmations and focus my mind, remind myself of what I wanted, why I wanted it, what I was committed to doing to achieve it. I did a minute of jumping jacks, right? And I was like out of breath, right? My heart, I feel 10 times more awake than I felt before the jumping jacks. I go through all these and I finished the 6 minutes and I go, wow. And I kind of assessed and I go, I feel like the benefits I just got are about 80% of when I do an hour long miracle morning. And I got that in 1/10 of the time. And I thought, there are not too many things you can do 1/10 of the time and get 80% of the benefit. And so I started, you know, I don't recommend you do the miracle morning, the 6 minute version every day, but it's kind of that whole, there's very little excuse to not do it, right? We can always fit in 6 minutes. And it shows the miracle morning is scalable. It could be 6 minutes, 12 minutes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 3 hours, etc. And I know people that do all of those variations, you know?
Right.
And the last thing I wanted to share, Mimica, before we wrap up, is if you are listening and you're like, man, this sounds interesting, but I am not a morning person. Like, I don't even want to try this. I would say you're probably with 70% of the people that that read The Miracle Morning, right? Probably the most important chapter in the book is the wake-up strategy. It's a five-step wake-up strategy. And these steps are so simple. They're designed to do, a couple of them are done the night before, but the majority are done first thing in the morning when you wake up, when you're half asleep and you have almost no willpower. And that by the time you're done with the steps, it's 10 times easier to wake up. And it was funny, I was speaking to a group of CEOs out in New York about 6 months ago, and the CEO that introduced me, David Schnurman, he runs a company called Lawline. He said, I don't know if Hal's going to mention this or not, but he's got these, it's this like 3-page chapter in the book. It's these 5 steps. He calls it the snooze-proof wake-up strategy. He says, it's been a total game changer. I've never in my life been a morning person until I applied these 5 steps. And he goes, now I wake up at 5 a.m. every day, and it's easy. It's no big deal. And I really think that chapter is the most important chapter in the book, because if it wasn't for that chapter, I think the majority of people would not, you know, they wouldn't have a way that to beat the snooze button. You know, they right. might be sold on the idea, and they see the benefits. They believe in the lifesavers, but they're like, I tried it, but I failed. And it's this little chapter in the book, the 5-minute miracle morning, or the 5-step snooze-proof wake-up strategy, that is a game changer. So if you're not a morning person, that's where I literally encourage people. In fact, let me see. I encourage people to go to that chapter first. So it's chapter 5, page 47. So go there first so that you and read that and be like, oh, okay, I'm going to do this, right? And then your miracle morning can start by you just waking up, you know, like 10 minutes earlier and just reading the miracle morning book for your miracle morning until you learn all the lifesavers and all that.
Well, I'm excited because I know for me, I need to swap my coffee for clarity. So I'm going to be using the 6 minutes or the 10 or however long, because, you know, I have 3 kids that always go off to school at different times. But I know if I don't make time for myself, it ain't going to happen. So there you go. Bye-bye, Starbucks. Hello, clarity. Mornings, here we go. I'm determined. We're going to make this work.
Awesome.
So for anyone who's listening, I challenge you to read the book. Start with small little baby steps and work your way up. It just all starts with the first step, and that's what I'm always encouraged about. These things don't have to be huge and overwhelming. We can just start with something small.
Sure.
So I definitely will say, we'll have all the links to the book, but if you are listening today, make sure to go and leave a review on iTunes for our podcast, as well as click to subscribe to my YouTube channel. I love to have more friends to share our good news with it. And if you like the video, click to subscribe and share it with your friends. I'm sure you know someone who's heard what Hal had to say today that would really benefit from hearing about the Miracle Morning. And if you want more freebie downloads that I give only to my newsletter community, go to mimicacooney.com and grab our downloads there we have available for you today. So I'm going to say thanks again, Hal, for joining me. I so appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule. And just tell the audience how we can best find you online.
Yeah, you can find me on my website, halelrod.com, if you want to contact me. Probably the best place to plug into, and Mimica, this is for you too, is the Miracle Morning community on Facebook. Are you in there yet?
Not yet. I'm just kind of getting in there, so I'll need to do that today.
It will blow your mind. We have 14,000 members now, and it's quality, though, over quantity. It is the most engaged, supportive online community that I have ever seen. I mean, I'll see people come in that are new to the community. They've never been there, and they say hello, and they maybe ask a question, or they ask for advice. And by the end of the day, they have 50, 60, 70 comments from people in the community encouraging them, giving them advice, answering questions, etc. So anybody listening, even before you get the book, come join the Miracle Morning community on Facebook. And let me give you the URL to put in the show notes. It's mytmmcommunity.com. So mytmm, as in the Miracle Morning, community.com. mytmmcommunity.com is the direct link, or you can just go to Facebook and search for the Miracle Morning community. And then last but not least, if your listeners want, if anybody's listening or watching and money's tight right now, like it's so tight that you and your spouse have agreed, we can't spend any extra money, I don't care if it's $5 or $10, any extra money on anything that's not a required necessity, You can go to miraclemorning.com and you can get the first few chapters of the book for free. You can get a 15-minute video training for free and a 60-minute audio training for free. All of that at miraclemorning.com. And that way you can start doing the Miracle Morning without having to buy the book.
Right. Well, I appreciate that. That's a lot of great, valuable content that's given to you to be able to take use of. So we'll make notes of that as well, but make sure you go there and go to miraclemorning.com. And that's what I love about it, is it's all this empowerment of helping others, people helping other people, pull them up towards, you know, a higher level so we can all achieve something, what we're dreaming and we've been aspiring to all our lives, except we stopped dreaming when we were like six, right?
Yeah, no, you're right. And that's the mission. The Miracle Morning mission is to change millions of lives one morning at a time. So Mimica, thank you so much for helping me to do that and share it with your audience.
Sure. Well, I appreciate it. Thanks so much for being with us on the show this week. And thanks to everyone listening. Until next time, take care. Yes, that's right. Like paprika. So we've got there. There we go. Fabulous. You have gremlins in your equipment, darling. It's like just definitely. Well, I know I have to work on myself because I have not been a mornings person. So I'm like, I'm redoing my habits.
If you feel stuck not knowing what to do to get started with video, or if you don't like how you look or sound on camera, you're going to love Confident Video. Learn how to create fabulous looking videos to market your business and brand at confidentvideo.com. Get the free 3-part video series and get started today easily with video marketing. Confidentvideo.com.